Let's have our lecture video in Highway and Railroad Engineering under the topic Pavement Design. Fundamentally, a paved surface performs two basic functions. Number one, it helps guide drivers by giving them a visual perspective of the horizontal and vertical alignment of the traveled path, thus giving drivers information relating to the driving task and the steering control of the vehicle. Number two, it supports vehicle loads, and it is this second function that will focus on our lecture. As with any structure, the underlying soil must ultimately carry the load that is placed on it. A pavement's function is to distribute the traffic load stresses to the soil or the subgrade at a magnitude that will not shear or distort the soil. Typical load bearing or typical soil bearing capacities can be less than 50 pounds per square inch or 50 psi, and in some cases as low as 2 to 3 pounds per square inch or 2 to 3 psi. When soil is saturated with water, the bearing capacity can be very low, and in these cases it is very important for pavement to distribute tire loads to the soil in such a way as to prevent failure of the pavement structure. So kung mapapansin, nabanggit dito na kailangan hindi magkaroon ng shear or distortion sa soil. As much as possible, huwag magkaroon ng permanent distortion sa soil. Kasi once na nagkaroon ng permanent distortion sa soil, magkakaroon na rin ng failure doon sa pavement structure. Kasi ang function ng soil natin is it serves as the support doon sa ating pavement structure. Now, if that support has failed, hindi na niya mabubuhat ng maayos yung pavement structure na nakapatong sa kanya. Kaya, kailangan na pag-aralan yung pavement design. Now, as for the pavement types, there are two primary pavement types. We have the first one, the flexible pavements, and the second one is the rigid pavements. There are other types as well, and three of them yung nakalista dito. The first one is the composite pavements. So from the word composite, they are made of both rigid and flexible pavement layers. So combination siya. Number two, we have the continuously reinforced pavements. So from the word continuously reinforced, so tuloy-tuloy na merong bakal dun sa pavement natin. So bubuhusan na lang siya. So para siyang sa slab. Next, number three, the post-tensioned pavements. So here are the examples, pictures. So itong first picture natin dito is a composite pavement. Kung makikita, meron tayong flexible pavement or yung asphalt pavement dun sa ibabaw. And then meron din tayong concrete pavement dun sa ilalim ng ating asfalto. So that is composite pavement. Then we also have here a continuously reinforced pavement. So makikita yung bakal tuloy-tuloy. So after yan talian yung mga bakal na yan, bubuhusan na lang siya ng semento. Then number three, we have the post-tensioned pavements. So from this picture, we have the precast concrete. So sinasalpak na lang siya. Tapos na siyang construct and then sasalpak na lang. Okay, so let's focus on the two pavement types. The first one, the flexible pavement. Flexible pavement is constructed with asphaltic cement and aggregate. So ito yung kanyang composition. And usually consist of several layers as shown in the figure. So this is the figure. The lower layer is called the subgrade, the soil itself. Here, the upper 6 to 8 inches of the subgrade is usually scarified, blended to provide a uniform material before it is compacted to maximum density. So before siya patungan ng pavement, pre-prepare muna yung subgrade o yung soil bago siya lagyan ng pavement. So from this picture, so makikita, pini-prepare nila yung subgrade natin. And it says there, dapat uniform yung material. And then, after malagyan ng uniform material, it should be compacted to its maximum density. So, gaya na ng na-mention kanina, this subgrade, this soil, serves as the support for the pavement. So, dapat talaga dito is, as much as possible, stable siya. So, dito, nilalatagan siya ng uniform material. Matapos latagan yan, so, babasahin, and then, pison. So, ayan na yung pison natin. So, gamit yung roller. And, hanggang to the point na ma-attain yung maximum density niya o yung pagkakakumpak ng mga material niya. And then, after ng subgrade natin, we have the sub-base. So, sa ibabaw ng subgrade is the sub-base. The sub-base usually consists of crushed aggregate or rocks. This material has better engineering properties or higher modulus values than the subgrade material in terms of its bearing capacity. So, yung sabihin, itong sub-base natin is mas matibay siya compared dun sa material ng sub-base natin. Mas kaya niyang mag-carry ng load compared kay subgrade material. So, here, yan, nilalatagan ng crushed aggregate yung ating subgrade. So after ng subgrade, patungan mo siya ng subbase. The next layer is the base layer and is often made of crushed aggregates din. So pareha sila, crushed aggregates din. Of a higher strength than those used in the subbase. So kaibahan lang ng base layer natin sa subbase is mas mataas yung strength, higher ang strength ng aggregates ng ating base layer compared sa subbase. So which is either unstabilized or stabilized with a cementing material. So the cementing material yung gagamitin natin na para mag-bind yung ating mga aggregates, it could be Portland cement, lime fly ash, or asphaltic cement. So, either sa tatlong yan ang gagamitin para i-bind yung mga aggregates ng base layer natin. And then, after ng base layer, we have the wearing surface. So, this wearing surface is usually made of asphaltic concrete, which is a mixture of asphalt cement and aggregates. The purpose of the wearing layer is to protect the base layer from wheel abrasion and to waterproof the entire pavement structure. So, yun yung purpose niya. Yun yung purpose ng ating asphaltic concrete is to protect the base layer from wheel abrasion and to waterproof the entire pavement structure. Then, it also provides a skid-resistant surface that is important for safe vehicle stops. Kasi kung madulas yung kalsada natin upon stepping on the brake, so hindi siya agad-agad na mag-stop or hindi safe yung kagat ng brake natin or yung hindi siya talaga stop at a desired distance. Okay? So that is the purpose for the wearing surface or the asphaltic concrete layer. Now, these are the typical thicknesses of the individual layers. These thicknesses vary with the type of axle loading, available materials, and expected pavement design life, which is the number of years the pavement is expected to provide adequate service before it must undergo major rehabilitation. So, makikita natin doon sa figure, ang usual na or typical na thickness for the wearing surface is 2 to 4 inches. For the base layer, we have 4 to 10 inches. And then the subbase layer is 4 to 10 inches. Then it varies. As you can see, meron tayong limit. Meron tayong minimum 4, maximum 10. Depende kasi yan sa yung loadings na gagamit dun sa ating pavement. Kung yun ba ay mga mabibigat na sasakyan gaya ng mga truck. Of course, it is gagamit ka talaga ng mas makapal na or mas mas higher na thickness kung mas mabibigat na sasakyan ang gagamit compared kung ang dadaan lang is mga tricycle, kuliglig. So, mas magaan yung mga yon. So, mas gagamit ka ng mas manipis na thickness for those types of loadings. Then, available materials. So, dun sa lugar ba na yon, maraming dun sa site ba or sa malapit sa site is plenty ba mga crush aggregates natin? Plenty ba yung asphaltic materials natin doon? Or yung cement ba natin, madami doon? So, it depends. Kung papaano rin na ang natin, availability ng materials natin. Then, we have the expected pavement design life. So, if your pavement design, if you have designed it to last for only 5 years, obviously, hindi mo siya kakapalan. Kasi, 5 years lang gamit. Compared with the 10 to 15 years na gagamitin siya. Okay, so kakapalan natin. So, halimbawa sa highway natin, major highways. So, we are expecting sana na mas matagal pa. So, kakapalan na natin. Okay, so that is for the flexible pavement. So, dun sa flexible pavement natin, ayan. Ito na yung paglalatag nung so after na na-prepare na so ito na yung ating base course. Nalatagan na siya ng asphaltic material na asfalto, yung maitim na yan na naluto na. Okay, after the flexible pavement, we go to the rigid pavements. A rigid pavement is constructed with Portland cement concrete or PCC and aggregates. So, ito naman yung composition niya. The PCC and the aggregates as shown in the figure. As with the flexible pavements, the subgrade or the lower layer, so yon, is often scarified, blended, and compacted to maximum density. So, gaya ng flexible pavement preparation natin kanina, kailangan yung subgrade din ng rigid pavement is ni-scarify din. Dapat, same materials din siya all throughout. And then, kinukompact din siya. So, the same preparation ng subgrade. In rigid pavements, the base layer is optional. Okay, take note. So, the base layer, itong layer na to is optional. Yung 4 to 8 inches na yan. Why? Why optional? Kasi, depending on the engineering properties of the subgrade. Kung yung subgrade, sabi dito, if the subgrade soil is poor and erodible, then it is advisable to use a base layer. However, sabi dyan, if the soil has good engineering properties and drains well, a base layer need not be used. Okay. So, madalas kapag kunwari yung subgrade material natin is hindi siya nagde-drain well, halimbawa yung mga hindi nagde-drain well na klase ng soil, is yung mga clay soil. Kung mapapansin, kapag clay yung soil natin, pag tag-ulan, so sa mga clay, na iipon agad yung tubig. Hindi siya basta-basta nawawala. Kahit na ang taas-taas na ng araw, hindi siya basta-basta nawawala. I-compare mo yan sa mga sandy soil. Yung mga sandy soil, so after ng ulan, so nawawala na agad yung mga puddles natin kasi nagsisip na siya underground. The top layer, the wearing surface, is the Portland cement concrete slab. So, ito yung top layer natin, which is the PCC na natin. Slab length varies from a spacing of 10 to 13 feet to a spacing of 40 feet or more. Transverse construction joints are built into the pavement to control cracking due to shrinkage of the concrete during the curing process. So, during the curing process, yun yung binabasa yung kalsada after na na place na yung concrete, binabasa yung kalsada. That is the curing process para ma-attain niya yung kanyang strength of the concrete. Ngayon, during that process of curing, nagkakaroon ng crack. So, kung kunwari tuloy-tuloy yung pagkakabuhos niya and hindi ka nag-provide ng contraction joint dito, parang spacing dyan. So, nagkakaroon siya ng cracks. So, the cracks will be discussed later on kung ano yung cause niya. Okay? So, kailangan talaga ng contraction joint for that. Load transfer devices such as dowel bars, ito yung dowel bars natin, are placed in the joints to minimize deflection and reduce stresses near the edges of the slabs. Slab thicknesses for PCC highway pavements usually vary from 8 to 12 inches as shown in this figure. Okay, so tinukoy niya kanina. So ito siya. Okay, so in this picture, you can see the placing of the concrete, the pouring of the concrete. So, of course, dapat na-prepare talaga yung base niya, kung base man ito or subgrade man yan. Again, kanina, depende, optional lang yung base na layer. Kung okay naman yung subgrade, hindi, huwag ka na maglagay ng base layer. So, what's happening here is, as the concrete is being poured in this portion, dinidistribute naman yung concrete natin. And then, meron tayong screeder doon para pantay yung taas ng ating concrete. So, dapat ito yung form niya sa gilid. Okay, yun yung forma. Dadaan dyan yung screeder natin para pantay lang yung taas o thickness ng ating concrete pavement. Then, that is the vibrator, concrete vibrator, that is required para nang sa ganon magiging even yung distribution ng ating mga aggregates, kasi this concrete contains aggregates. Without the use of the vibrator here, hindi magiging even yung distribution ng aggregates natin dito. And then, kung wala ito, magkakaroon ng voids yung ating mga concrete. And if those voids are present dito sa concrete natin, then, delikado yan kasi magkukos din yan ng cracks. So, mas maganda talaga, dense na siya. So, para makuha yung density niya, kailangan mo ng concrete vibrator. So, here is the, para maintindihan natin yung difference ng dowel bars sa tie bars. Okay? Again, this is the concrete pavement natin. Ito yung isang lane, itong part na to, is one lane yan. Then, another lane na naman dito. Okay? So, madalas talaga, pag binubuhos natin yung konkreto natin, piniprepare muna natin yung isang lane. Then, dyan natin binubuhusan muna yung concrete natin bago natin i-prepare doon sa kabila. So, habang tuloy-tuloy yung pag-construct natin dito, okay, you need to remember, sabi doon, maglagay tayo ng transverse joint. So, here, maglagay ng transverse joint. And this is the longitudinal joint. Yung separation ng first na lane doon sa second lane. Compare mo dito sa transverse joint. Now, dito sa transverse joint natin, matatagpuan yung tinatawag na dowel bars. So, yan. Connecting one joint to another. So, nakonekta niya to dito. Then, this is the tie bars connecting the two lanes. Matatagpuan siya doon sa ating longitudinal joint. So, that's the difference for the dowel bars and the tie bars. Okay, so this is now our dowel bar. Mapapansin dahil nandito yung isang lane. So, ito naman yung dowel bar. So, that is our tie bars. Tie bar kasi along siya sa longitudinal joint natin. Pavement system design principles for flexible pavements. It says here the primary function of the pavement structure is to reduce and distribute the surface stresses or contact tire pressure to an acceptable level at the subgrade to a level that prevents permanent deformation. A flexible pavement reduces the stresses by distributing the traffic wheel loads over greater and greater areas through the individual layers until the stress at the subgrade is at an acceptably low level. The traffic loads are transmitted to that subgrade by aggregate-to-aggregate particle contact. Confining pressures or lateral forces due to material weight in the subbase and base layers increase the bearing strength of these materials. A cone of distribution loads reduces and spreads the stresses to the subgrade as shown in the figure. So the wheel load as a point load here is being distributed in a shape of a cone. So habang papailalim, nadidistribute na rin yung stresses para pagdating dito sa subgrade natin is mas lower na yung natatanggap niya na stresses para hindi naman siya nakadirekta lang sa iisang spot dito. So yun yung purpose, kaya nakita natin kanina mas weaker yung material dito, papataas. So papataas yung engineering property niya. Kasi the purpose is ayun nga to distribute yung load na natatanggap mula dito sa wearing surface natin. Again, ang target natin is to avoid permanent deformation dun sa subgrade level natin, subgrade layer natin. Traditional HASHTO flexible pavement design procedure. There are several accepted flexible pavement design procedures available, including the first one, Asphalt Institute method, the second one, the National Stone Association procedure, the number three, the shell procedure, and the number four, mechanistic empirical pavement design guide. Most of the procedures have been field verified and used by highway agencies for several years. The selection of one procedure over another is usually based on a highway agency's experience and satisfaction with design results. So, based talaga yan sa kung ano yung mas, sa tingin is, mas okay dun sa apat na nabanggit na yon. And, field verified siya. Meaning, ginawa siya sa field and then what works is, yun yung nire-record nila as, yun na nga ginagawang pattern. A traditional and widely accepted flexible pavement design procedure is presented in the AASHTO Guide for Design for Pavement Structures, which is published by the American Association of State Highway and Transportation Officials, or AASHTO. So, ito yung mostly na ginagamit din dito sa Pilipinas. So ito yung i-discuss natin mostly, yung sa may ash to, which will be discussed more later on sa mga last chapters natin or last na study guides natin. Payment can be subjected to a number of detrimental effects, including fatigue failures, cracking, which are the result of repeated loading caused by traffic passing over the pavement. The pavement is also placed in an uncontrolled environment that produces temperature extremes and moisture variations. The combination of the environment, traffic loads, material variations, and construction variations requires a comparatively complex set of design procedures to incorporate all of the variables. The ASHTO pavement design procedure meets most of the demands placed on a flexible pavement design procedure. It considers environment, load, and materials in a methodology that is relatively easy to use. The ASHTO pavement design procedure has been widely accepted throughout the United States and around the world. So ito yung talagang rason kung bakit ASHTO din ang gamit dito sa Pilipinas. Let's discuss more this on the next video.